Let's sing Amazing Grace. Let's stand.
Last year, my grandma was talking about how beautiful my grandpa's services were because the grandkids stood up and shared memories of him, and I reminded her the other number one did that, not me, and they stopped her walker in its tracks to tell me I better stand up here and tell you guys how great she is. And she really was. Baking cookies to playing Skip-O. You know, I remember my dad planned this big trip to North Carolina or South Carolina, and last minute, I was little, I didn't want to go. And my mom called my grandma, and my grandma took me for that week, you know, as my dad's driving away, and my dad said, someday you're gonna regret it. Not mean, but trying to talk me into going like a dad should, and I've got a lot of regrets in my life, and that wasn't one. You know, she was really good. I'm mowing the yard, another one. Grandpa, you know, there would be snakes, and I'd run to get my grandparents, and if I got Grandpa, he'd put the snake in a bucket and take it to the pond, and not my grandma. My grandma went out there with a hoe and she chopped that snake right in half, you know. And she really was my hero, and she's half the reason I am who I am today, why I do what I do. And I'm really blessed that I had her in my life and that I was able to be there when I grew up too. And my kids didn't know her that well, but she knew my kids because I told her, you know. And I'm just, that's it.
Yes, I'm a great grandchild. Two things. Across the country. sat here 3 hours while he had to take the car off the back of the camper and go into town and get a fuel pump, and I'd be like, Mom. And she, oh, we broke down too. I think every state, at least twice, they broke down going back and forth across the country. Or she'd go, oh, your dad went the wrong way then. And I'm like, what did you do? She goes, I just kept on going. I said, I told him, one more time you go the wrong way, I don't care how far you go. And he did. I think he made it about 100 miles. There was always the, I left my purse in this restaurant. I don't know how far they got. They had to turn around and go back. And then spitting on a Pulaski. One time they went from Lacona to Pulaski CNM and sat there like 6 hours. They couldn't even get out of the state of New York trying to get out of here. The other thing I'd like to say, and I'm so glad the church is beautiful today. And if we could fill this place with stuff that Mom made that is so beautiful. And she was a very, very creative person. Really, really proud of it. So, thank you.
Good. That's great. Yeah, like I say, we're recording this, and I can destroy it or keep it, so if it gets really bad, I'll just destroy the video, you know, whatever. Okay. But you're doing really good. That's great. Anyone else?
I'm going to try to get through it without crying, but I probably won't. I've been reflecting in the last week about what kind of grandma my grandma was, what kind of great grandma she was. She wasn't somebody that was going to run in and hug you as soon as you saw her. She wasn't going to smooch you with kisses. And she didn't say, I love you a lot. She wasn't real expressive in that way with her emotions. But in the quiet moments is when I knew my grandma loved me. Baking cookies, peanut butter balls, every stitch of a quilt she prayed over. She used to drive me crazy because she would tell me when she was with me about all the other grandkids and how wonderful they were. And I'd be like, geez, lady, I'm spending time with you right now. But she was so proud of each and every one of us. And that's the way I'll remember my grandma, is in the quiet moment. So I hope you guys take some time to reflect on what that means for you.
As you notice, there's boxes of Kleenexes all over the place, okay? So this is the second of three funerals we have in a week's time around here. But all have been just great, and to hear the stories of people that have lived a full life and impacted their family. Anyone else? That's great.
I've known Pat all of my life, and my family's life and the Brown family life has been entwined forever. The stories and the memories, complaints, everything. But the one thing I will say that Pat taught me was about friendship, lifelong friendship. You can't make new old friends. And those are the people who you're going to want to count on days like today, and days when your son goes to the military, or your husband is ill, or you're off and your daughter's having a baby somewhere else. I mean, your friendship with families are what is so important and what hold us all together. And I will miss Pat.
Everybody used to say, how's your mom? And I'd say, she's meaner than a junkyard dog, so she's doing good. and but I do want all you grandkids and great-grandkids to know that even if you weren't close with her, there wasn't a single one of you that was born. She wasn't ecstatic over the fact that you were part of our family. She loved each and every one of you in her own way. She did. She always loved a baby. And I had some time with her on her last day here, and I told her how much we all loved her, and that we all knew that she loved us. And I told her to tell Dad we all said hi.
This can be the most dangerous part of a funeral, you know that, but it also could be the most exciting part. I'm learning a lot.
Okay, I had to write it down. I'm not good with this. But what everyone has said, it's like so true of Aunt Pat. So before expressing my loving memories of Aunt Pat, I have to mention her parents, Gerald and Mary. I never had grandparents present, so whenever I was with them, they were my grandparents. Their love and kindness was shown to everyone. I recall my mother, a newly arrived immigrant, was welcomed and nurtured to American life by them. I feel I had to mention this so Aunt Pat and even their influence on Uncle Alex had instilled the loving, kind, outstanding people they were, always pulling their sleeves up to make life a little easier for others. I always enjoyed going to Aunt Pat's house, swimming in one of their ponds, accompanying their family to the beach with Aunt Sally. As I grew older, I appreciated her and Uncle Alex's support. Through life's hardships and joys, they were always there, but in the back, not drawing any attention to their good deeds that they'd shown. I admired her interest in quilting, her faith, her decorating and feeding the birds, and gardening. She was a very talented woman. As I grew even older, it was nice having Aunt Pat around to talk about the old days and ask about people from the past. She was our go-to for that generation. Aunt Pat has a legacy, which we've heard today, of loving kind children, grandchildren, and many great-grandchildren who loved and cared for her. That to me is truly a fulfilling life that has meaning. Rest in peace, Aunt Pat.
Wave your hand if you want the microphone. Some of you are hot. They're doing this, so I hand them the mic, right?
So I got to know my aunt and uncle when I lived in Vegas. And I got to know my cousin Lex, too, then. But what I can tell you is I can't share most of my memories that I have with my Aunt Pat because there's too many children in the room. Straight up, can't tell you what she said to me. But it was definitely different as an adult being around her and him. And yeah, she didn't say you love you that much, but if you said it to her, she said it back. And she was, when I was so desperate up here, she came in and dug her hands into ants and everything else with me, making sure my kids had a place to live. So she did do a lot, even though she didn't really say it. But again, if you ever want to know those other stories, come talk to me. They're pretty interesting.
That's why you have a get-together afterwards, right? For those. All right. So save your good stories for later, all right? Get you going, all right? That's right. There you go. Yeah. I'm going to give you my story. I appreciate this quilt. The first year I came back to church 3 years ago, my brother got cancer. got real sick, and the quilting ministry presented him with a quilt, which is on my mom's couch. And what it taught me was there's a lot of things we have, I'm not preaching yet, but we think about death. We always say, well, so-and-so is looking down upon us, which kind of scares me sometimes that my father might be looking down upon us. But I thought about this. Our family members do things for us that are always with us. Sometimes it's very tangible like this. So whenever every time I see that quilt, I think of all the ladies, Pat and others, who ministered to many people that they never met, extending that love. And so there's ways that they are kind of looking down upon us, remind us that all the stuff they left, the stories, the things they made, they remind us that they're still with us. Kathy?
Well, my remembrance of Pat has been back even when I was a teenager coming here. And at the death of my parents, I sung at my mom's funeral. And not long after that, Pat came up to me and she asked, would you be willing to sing that song at my funeral? Of course, 17 years ago, I said, of course. And hadn't seen very much of her, just here and there. And then a couple years ago, I saw her. And she's like, you're still planning on singing, right? And I'm like going, of course, I will be sure to do that. Well, I get a voicemail from Pastor Glenn, and, you know, I am in the midst of helping my son move and his wife, and I'm looking at the voicemail, and I'm like, oh, man, you know, my heart saddened, but then I'm like, oh, I know what this is about. So bear with me. I could not find the music. I have it in my head, but listen to the words, because I know this is very dear to Pat and her wish for every one of you. I dreamed I'd gone to that city where never comes night, and I saw the bright angels of glory. I saw the fair mansions on high. I gazed for long years of rapture on the face of my Savior so true. And I sang with the seraphim holy. Then I dreamed I searched heaven for you. I dreamed I searched heaven for you. Searched vainly through heaven for you. Friend, won't you prepare to meet me up there? Lest I should search heaven for you. I looked on both sides of the river that flows through the city of God. I searched through bright mansions celestial and streets of gold pavement I trod. There are faces of saints by the millions. I scan in my yearning to see the face I cherish so fondly, the face that had grown dear to me. I dreamed I searched heaven for you. Searched vainly through heaven for you. Friend, won't you prepare to meet me up there, lest I just search heaven for you. I asked the 10,000 sweet angels, have you seen my beloved one? Pray tell, the one whom on earth I have loved so well. They shook their heads sadly, no. Sorry. I knew that somewhere in the darkness, you wander lost out in sin. I dreamed I searched heaven for you, searched vainly through heaven for you. Friend, won't you prepare to meet me up there, lest I should search heaven for you.
I want to talk to you about rest. I know that, remember Mr. Rogers? How many remember Mr. Rogers? You kids say, who is he talking about? Well, he was a nice guy on TV that would talk so calm for us hyper kids, you know, and calm us down. And years ago, I was in doing a funeral and went into a funeral home, and they had a little thing by Mr. Rogers. And it was how to talk to kids about the death of a loved one. And I really found it was really helpful, because if you didn't know this, Mr. Rogers was a Presbyterian minister. Did you know that? It's almost as good as a Wesleyan minister, but he was, you know, I'm sorry. But one thing he said was, oftentimes we confuse children when we say that, well, grandma's gone to sleep. Because every time someone they love goes to sleep, they're afraid they won't wake up. But the Bible uses that phrase, asleep in the Lord. So we want to clarify that with some scripture today to tell you that finally we are at rest when we pass away in the Lord. It's a great rest. It's a good rest, I like to call it. Nice rest. Now, when you're kids, you fight naps, you know, like I have grandchildren, and I remember my daughter was working at a preschool or a daycare, and she said the kids would play as hard as they could, as long as they could, and fall asleep wherever they were. You ever see that happen? Like at the bottom of the slide, you know. And we would fight it as kids. Now that I'm older, not as old as some of you, I value rest. I value even a nap sometimes. It's hard to admit. So, because you only sleep so many hours at night when you get to be our age, you know, you have to get up for, you know why. But good rest. In fact, it's a scriptural term, a spiritual term that God uses for us entering into his rest. How many here could use some good rest? Yeah, I could use some anyway, but been a busy week. But let me talk to you about the scripture says here in scripture says in John 11:11, this is the story of Jesus going to a funeral, and he gets there and his friend has died. You probably know the story. His name was Lazarus, and he's only dead for a little while. And this is what Jesus said in verse 11 of John 11. These things he said, and after he said them, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up. Now, later we find in the New Testament these words, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and now rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Christ. For this we say to you, that by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. I kind of gather when people design their funeral ahead of time and they request certain songs, they want to get a message across. And Pat wants to get a message across to us and remind you of something. And that is about the idea that this life is not all there is. There is another life which is eternal, and we have an opportunity to enter into that life. But there's this thing called asleep in Christ that I want to talk to you about. So first of all, when I look at scripture about this idea of being asleep or falling asleep, what does it mean when Jesus says Lazarus was asleep? Well, first of all, asleep in the Lord is not being unconscious, because we find that when there's a reference to another man named Lazarus who, when he died, he went to be with other saints like Abraham, and they were very conscious. And others who were not righteous died, like the rich man who denied him his needs. He went to a place of torment, and he was very conscious when he went there. So there's a consciousness that remains with you, your soul, so to speak, which goes on beyond the existence of your body. So it's not unconscious. You're very conscious. Also, sleep in the Lord is not painful, because Jesus promised to the man hanging on the cross next to him, because he said, "Remember me, Lord." He said, "Then today you shall be with me in paradise." And paradise is a reference to a place of bliss and happiness and joy. And so it's not painful anymore. In fact, we read in the book of Revelation that when we die and we go to be with the Lord, it says that there's no more sorrow, there's no more tears, there's no crying. And that's why there's certain venues of country music that will not be there, okay? Because there's no crying in heaven. But it's a place that's no pain. Asleep in the Lord is, however, somehow temporary. Like Lazarus is asleep, but I go that I might wake him up. I always wonder what was going on for those 3 or 4 days when Lazarus was asleep. Was God saying, "By the way, you're going to be the first person to make a point about the power of my son Jesus by coming back to life"? And he's probably thinking, "It's pretty cool up here. I don't want to go back there." But he did. I understand that. And so he does not wake up everyone the way he did Lazarus, because he doesn't bring us back to this life. He wakes us up to a better life. And so the idea of being asleep, it's temporary, because Jesus is the one who awakens us. That's the neat thing. Now, I don't know who wakes you up in the morning, or what wakes you up in the morning. Does your cell phone wake you up in the morning? Does a train going by wake you up in the morning? Do the kids wake you up in the morning? How many of kids do that, you know? I have a cat that wakes me up in the morning. He wants me to feed him. And this morning I fed him, then he threw up on the floor. I said, "That was a waste of time." Now, if you've had a good night's sleep, it's nice to wake up in the morning. In fact, maybe you're like me, like the best part of waking up is what? Folgers in your cup, right? I don't even drink Folgers. But whatever it is, that first cup of coffee, it feels good to have a good night's rest and then wake up with the sun shining and maybe someone you love there with you. You know, like when you first get married and you're so excited to wake up with that person next to you. After a few weeks, you think, "Let me brush my teeth first." Right. But a good night's rest can lead to a good morning, can it? And finally, after all the struggles of life, Patricia, Pat, doesn't have that anymore. She has rest in the Lord. And the neat thing is, the person who is going to wake her up, and I believe has woke her up, however that fits in the whole time frame, God knows, and I'm not going to get theological about that. Ask some preacher somewhere. Oh, I am a preacher, but don't ask me till later on. The person who wakes up those who fall asleep in the Lord is Jesus Christ himself. And he raises us up to eternal life where there is no sorrow, pain, or sickness. He is the one who loves us more than anyone else, and he is the one who wakes us. And when we wake up, it's like awake from the sleep. We are given a new body, which is interesting. People say, "Well, I know someone in heaven when I get there." Yeah, you will, because it does tell us in the Bible that Abraham was known for who he was, and this poor man Lazarus was known for who he was, and there's a reference to Moses and Elijah, and so we'll be known for who he was, but we'll be different. In fact, the idea of a new body, it says somewhere it was, how are the dead raised up, and with what body do they come? He says, you foolish, what is sown is not made alive unless it dies. So this body is like a seed, but the DNA, the spiritual DNA of who we are in Christ, it raises up to a better body with no need of walkers and wheelchairs and hearing aids and glasses. A body as God reconstructs us by his miraculous powers. How can this be? Well, listen, if God can create the world and human beings from dust, and he can raise up, and he proved it by healing every disease and sickness and showing his authority over all of nature, he can raise us up. This is what Paul is saying. And so he raises up with a body that is incorruptible, which is like what we had before, and that is recognizable. So yes, when you get to heaven, you'll recognize that. What you sow, you do not sow the body that shall be, but what mere grain, perhaps, or wheat or some other grain. The idea of we put a seed in the ground, it doesn't grow up and become a seed, it becomes a plant, something more productive, better than before. Now, here's the thing about this body. It is a spiritual body. 1 Corinthians 15, 50-54 says, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood, this here, cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. This is corruptible, this body, but will inherit something that's incorruptible. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. And how do we get this body? Well, you must be born of the Spirit. In John chapter 3, verse 5, Jesus, he answered Nicodemus, who said, what do you mean born again? That's just not biologically correct. He says, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of the water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. So the way to get to heaven, where Pat is to be born of the Spirit. It's to invite Christ into your life. John chapter 1 says, but as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God. Light has come into our life. Jesus is the light of the world. And when he comes in and gives us life, the Spirit comes alive. And the Spirit will live forever. And it will live. We are spiritual beings now. Our body is corruptible. But who we are, our soul and our spirit will go on forever. So how do I enter the kingdom of heaven? You know, there's a lot of simple prayers people have. I need to be born in the Spirit. Perhaps you are familiar with the prayer Jesus taught us, which addresses what keeps us from being born of the Spirit, our sins. So he teaches us to confess our sins. And it teaches us to align our life with him. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. He teaches us to pray and trust in him every day. If you know that prayer, would you pray it with me? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Pat requested we sing a song that many of us who grew up in the era of Billy Graham will recognize this song, won't we? Just as I am. Let's do two verses of that. Let's stand. just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. Is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May the God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Amen. Please be seated.